Robert Sungenis, here we are in the lobby of the Scotiabank Center during the FANIMA conference, FANIMA, The Path to Peace. You're giving a talk related to FANIMA on the world situation in terms of wars on a global basis, which have been ongoing since the supposed consecration of Russia, that never mentioned Russia, in 1984. But today I'd like to talk about a different topic, one that you have specialized in, a provocative topic, one that elicits laughter from the modern mind, geocentrism, that the Earth is, in fact, the center of the universe. Now, I have to confess, long before you got involved, whenever I heard the proposition suggested by certain Protestant biblical fundamentalists that the Earth is the center of the universe, I would laugh, because I share the common prejudice against any discussion of the topic. But then I began to think to myself, wait a minute, I don't really accept the modern world's narrative about itself anyway. Evolution is obviously a preposterous theory, which will go down in history as one of the laughingstocks of scientific theory, along with Rudyard Kipling's Just So stories about how the giraffe got his neck. So then I stumbled across your material, and I began to read it, and I began to wade into the complexities of astrophysics, the theory of relativity, the general and special theory, and admission after admission by top physicists and astrophysicists that, even within Einstein's framework, it really doesn't make sense to dispute that Earth is the center of the universe. It depends upon how you position the question. So I think we should give you a hearing on this and address common objections to geocentrism, the theory that the Earth is the center of the universe. And the first objection is, well, how can the Earth, which is so small, have the Sun revolving around it instead of the other way around?
Yeah, well, this was Newton's problem, basically. He confined his mathematics to the solar system, and in that system, yeah, we would have to agree. The Earth would have to go around the Sun because the Sun is much more massive. But 200 years later, this guy named Ernst Mach came along, very famous physicist.
M-A-C-H?
M-A-C-H. He's where we get Mach 1, Mach 2 for sound. Okay. And he had a very profound influence on Einstein, as a matter of fact, Einstein's theories. And Mach said, well, the problem with Newton was you confined it to the solar system. Now if you expand that system out to the stars, you have a whole different system you have to take into account. And in that system, the Earth can be what Newton called the center of mass for the whole universe, or the center of gravity. And if it's the center of gravity or the center of mass, that means the whole universe could go around it very easily with Newtonian mechanics.
How would that work, if you could possibly break that down in terms that laymen can understand? And I have to tell people who are watching this, especially the loony left who thinks this is all ridiculous, if you look at your material, what you're talking about is, at its highest level, very sophisticated physics involving things that are beyond the comprehension of the average person. Not nonsense at all. But can you break it down in ways that an average person could understand when you talk about center of gravity?
Sure. If you are playing a tennis game and you have a bad game, and you throw your racket, you ever see the way that racket turns around?
Right.
Yeah, it goes wobbly. The reason it goes wobbly is because it's turning around the center of mass, not the geometric center, the center of mass. That is the center of all the mass that's added up in that tennis racket, all right? So just expand that now, that principle, out to the universe, and if the universe is equally balanced on all sides in its sphere, then you have a center of that mass.
Okay.
And anything can occupy that center of mass.
So it's a pivot, the Earth would be a pivot point.
Pivot point, yeah.
Okay, I understand. Here's another common objection. Now wouldn't the stars, if they're going to be revolving en masse around the Earth, wouldn't they all have to exceed the speed of light as they're revolving?
That would be no more true than if you were flying in the Concorde from Paris to New York and you couldn't talk to the man in front of you because you were going faster than the speed of sound.
Okay. Well, that's an interesting analogy.
Yeah.
So that you're saying that within the framework of the airplane, traveling at the speed of sound,
right,
interactions at less than the speed of sound are possible.
Oh, yeah. I mean, if the whole universe is rotating, the stars aren't rotating themselves. It's the whole universe that's rotating within that frame. Now, if you took Einstein's theory, Einstein would have no objections to this, because in Einstein's theory, the speed of an object is limited only in the special theory of relativity. So no scientist out there can say, oh, well, you can't say that. Well, of course we can, because his general theory of relativity allowed anything to go any speed it wanted to.
Now, you've discussed the admissions of physicists in that regard, applying Einstein's theory to the facts to say, well, sure, it depends upon your point of reference. You could have Earth as the center. Can you give us some indications of admissions at the high level, at the highest levels of physics by physicists regarding what you're talking about?
Yeah, one of Einstein's famous books written in 1938 called The Evolution of Physics. Now, the title itself is interesting because by the time he got to where he was in 1938, physics had evolved in his mind, you see. And it's interesting with Einstein's story because he invented special relativity in 1905 to answer the experiments that were done 25 years prior that showed the Earth wasn't moving in space. So he had to invent relativity. He had to get everything moving, because if he had something fixed, then he couldn't explain that experiment. That relativity theory, the special relativity theory, led him 10 years later to the general theory of relativity, because he had to add in gravity.
Well, why was that a problem? Why was gravity a problem?
Well, because everything in the world has gravity, you see. And if you're claiming certain things about the speed of light and you don't include gravity, you're going to have a lot of mistakes. So he eventually figured that out, had to put in gravity into the general theory. When he did, the general theory of relativity made geocentrism viable.
Because did he admit that?
He admitted it in his book, Evolution of Physics.
This is what impressed me about your collection of studies and information on this. Einstein's admissions, among others. Go ahead.
This was on page 212 of his book. Anybody can go look it up. And he has a paragraph in there. He says, basically, there's no difference between the Earth going around the Sun and the Sun going around the Earth, because they're just different coordinate systems.
By his own lights.
By his own lights. And that's what the general theory of relativity led him to. So, I mean, it's ironic. The very theory that he proposed to deny geocentrism led to another theory that made it viable.
By his own admission.
By his own admission.
That's simply remarkable. And it just goes to show how, as I say, you have to be skeptical of the modern world's entire story, which it tells about itself, which has to include evolution and the general theory of relativity as a way to explain the universe as we know it without positing stationary Earth. I think there's a motive at work here, because what you've told me so far is that the evidence is consistent by Einstein's own lights with a stationary Earth. And so what would be the motive for denying a stationary Earth? That's something we'll discuss in a few moments. But let me address a couple of these other common objections. You hear this objection about Copernicus's model being simpler and more accurate than the Ptolemaic epicycles. And or even by more elegant than Tycho Brahe's model. Can you distinguish the three models and tell us why that objection is unfounded?
Sure, yeah. Copernicus's model was actually more complicated than Ptolemy's model. He actually had more epicycles in his model than Ptolemy did. Ptolemy had 40, Copernicus had 48.
Why did Copernicus need 48 epicycles if the Earth is stationary?
Well, because he tried to put the planets in perfect circular orbits, and they just don't go in perfect circular orbits. And the reason he did so was he was trying to follow Aristotle, who believed the circle was perfect. And Copernicus wanted to resurrect that idea, which he did in his model. Once he did, everything started flying off the handle. And he had to create these little extra circles in order to keep everything on the path that we actually saw in the sky.
Ah, well, that leads to a sub-objection. Some people say, well, ha-ha, modern astronomy has shown that the orbits of the planets are not perfect circles, but elliptical. What kind of a god would give us these imperfect elliptical orbits? If what you're saying is true, why wouldn't all the planets have perfectly circular orbits?
Yeah, well, actually, they might have perfect circular orbits, but they go in different speeds. So there's another possibility to what we see as now the reigning elliptical model of Kepler.
Okay.
But even if we were to go just on an elliptical model, Kepler's that he developed in 1500s, well, you know who beat him to that before?
Who?
It was Ptolemy. Ptolemy developed this thing called the equant that allowed the planets to move on non-uniform orbits as they orbited the Sun. So he was way ahead of Kepler, in a sense, and his model was very simple.
You say non-uniform orbits, but that mean that some planets orbit differently from others?
They move at different speeds.
Different speeds?
Yes. So where Kepler had an elliptical orbit, Ptolemy had a near circular orbit, but he used epicycles and an equant to adjust it to what he saw in the sky.
Does Kepler's law, I don't know which one it is, still hold that a planet moving around the sun compared to another planet sweeps out an equal amount of distance in the same amount of time?
It's called his area law.
That still holds?
Yeah, if you have two foci in an elliptical orbit, that's going to happen, yeah.
Well, that still indicates some sort of precise regulation of the orbits that would suggest some kind of clockmaker involved.
Yes, and the fact is that Kepler's model doesn't work either.
Oh, okay. Yeah.
There's too many perturbations of the planets to get them exactly what is occurring in the sky.
Interesting. Now, do we have any admissions from astrophysicists in regard to the alleged greater simplicity of the Copernican model? Are any of them admitting that really, actually, the traditional classical model of the stationary Earth would work as well?
Oh yeah, many of them. I mean, all the famous scientists who are worth their salt, who know the physics, they know Einstein, they know Mach, and they know Newton. I haven't found anyone who has not admitted that the geocentric universe can be made viable by the very physics we know today.
You know, I'm seeing a strange parallel here. The theory of evolution is dogma today, of course. Anyone who questions it is a crackpot, except that when you read the literature, the evolutionists themselves are questioning it.
Mm.
And now, of course, in this context, we're told, oh, come on, the stationary Earth theory, that's ridiculous. Mm. Except that when you read the literature that you've compiled and cited to, you find that top-level astrophysicists and physicists are questioning it as well.
Yeah.
Can't admit it publicly.
Yeah, can't admit it publicly because they have too many sheepskins on the wall. You know, they have careers to save, and I understand that. And it takes somebody like me to go dig out the information and put it in a book so people can read it. But who has time?
Yeah, you know. I understand.
How long did it take you to start reading it?
Forever. Yeah. Forever. Now, here's another objection. Has there ever been an experiment done to prove that the Earth is revolving around the sun?
Yes, there was several experiments in the 1800s. Dominique Arago, Armand Fizeau, Augustin Fresnel, but one of the most famous was the Michelson-Morley experiment in 1887.
No. Tell us about that.
Well, they used light beams to measure whether the Earth was moving, and they found that there was no movement. The Earth has to be moving 30 kilometers per second to complete its annual revolution, and they found out that it wasn't moving Michelson could have calculated it to 1/100th of what he got in his experiment. That's how sensitive his instruments were.
What did the experiment involve in terms of apparatus, so we can get a concrete understanding of
Well, if the Earth is moving around the sun, and we shoot that light beam in the direction that the Earth is moving, okay, and then we shoot another light beam perpendicular to that, well, the one that's in the direction of the Earth's movement should be impeded in some way if it's moving through space, whereas this one that's going perpendicular would not be impeded.
Why not?
Because it's not going through space. It's just going north and south.
Okay.
Okay? And what they found, they expected to have a 30-kilometer difference between these two light beams. There was no difference. So the natural interpretation, and even Einstein admits this, Mach admits this, Born admits this, the natural interpretation is that the Earth isn't moving. So how do we get out of that? Well, you invent special relativity. And now you say, well, the reason that light beam wasn't affected when it went toward the motion of the Earth is because the apparatus shortened.
Huh?
Yeah. Michelson's apparatus shortened as it was going with the Earth in its orbit around the sun.
Wait, you're telling me that the contraction of mass was invented to explain away the results of the Michelson-Morley experiment?
Yes, and that's what my book will tell you, and it's been admitted by all the scientists.
Well, isn't there any experimental confirmation that as you approach the speed of light, there's a contraction effect? The impression is that there's all kinds of experimental confirmation.
That was invented. There's no proof to it. All the physicists will tell you there's no proof.
Not that I'm surprised, you understand.
Yeah.
I know what the scientific community is capable of in terms of mass deception. Mm. Evolution is a mass deception. But I wasn't aware that they don't really have any even purported scientific confirmation in terms of physical measurement.
No, nobody
of the contraction effect.
Nobody measured a contraction. But they put it into a mathematical formula called the Lorentz transform, and it's probably the most famous equation used in physics today.
Does anyone expressly admit that, hey, we had to come up with this contraction effect because otherwise we're stuck with a motionless
Earth? Yes, the very guy who invented it.
Tell me what he admitted.
Heinlicher Red says, I don't have any other explanation to this experiment of Michael Samorley unless I can track the apparatus. Otherwise, we're going to have to believe the Earth is standing still in space.
Unbelievable.
Yeah.
Can you give an approximate page reference for me to your book? I want to go back and read that right away.
I'll send you an email. I'll show you where it is.
Here's another objection. If everything is moving, in other words, all the stars in the universe are moving, how could we possibly determine if we are the center of this moving universe?
Well, you know, it's interesting that you ask that, because in 2009 they sent up a probe called the Planck probe. It just came back with the results in 2013 in March. I don't know if you heard about it or not.
No.
The European Space Agency set it up in cooperation with NASA. This was the third attempt that they had to nullify the data that they were finding in the cosmic microwave background radiation that permeates the whole universe, that the Earth was in the center of the universe. The first one they sent up was in 1990 called the COBE probe. It came back, showed the Earth was in the center. The WMAP was the second one in 2001, came back with the same data. And what they tried to do was say that this was all an error. It was some kind of misreading, or it was there was contamination in the apparatus or the sky or whatever. So they sent up a third probe in 2009, just came back in 2013. Guess what? Same exact results. Same exact results. And what were the interpretations? Well, the Earth has to be in the center of the universe. And we have somebody quoted in our book, Lawrence Krauss of the Arizona State University, who says, yeah, this means we're in the center of the universe.
Let's pick up on that point a bit. You mentioned that the background radiation, microwave radiation, in the universe supplied data from which it became apparent that the Earth was, in fact, at the center of a moving universe. Explain why that is so. Why do these data confirm that?
Okay. Well, the Big Bang theory predicts that there was an explosion 13.7 billion years ago. Okay? So if there was an explosion, then that means the explosion had to come out equal on all sides of the sphere. It had to be what they call homogeneous. Okay? And that's naturally accepted. It's like homogenized milk.
Sure.
You know, you shake that thing up and you can't see one place from another place. It's all homogenized. And that's what they needed for this Big Bang universe. What they found when they sent these three probes up, yeah, some of it was homogeneous, but it's like having a bowl full of Jell-O with two swords going through the middle of the Jell-O.
What are the swords?
The swords are the orientation of the cosmic microwave background radiation throughout the universe.
What do you mean by the orientation?
Okay, there's hot and cold spots they found. It's not homogeneous. There's hot and cold spots in this microwave background radiation, and if you align all these cold spots, it forms an X through the whole universe.
Unbelievable.
And guess what's in the middle?
Oh, you're kidding.
No.
This is what the data show.
This is what the data shows.
Okay, come on now. What mainstream publication recognizes
this? The University of Michigan, Dragon Hutterer, Craig Copey, Glenn Starkman. These are all the guys who have done all the work on this microwave radiation. They read it in their papers. They wrote one in 2004, 2008, 2010, and 2012, and they're writing another one on the Planck probe.
So you're saying these space probes were designed to explain away the X represented by the hot and cold spots?
They wanted to make sure it wasn't an accident.
Okay, so there were how many probes in total?
Three in 20 years.
And you're saying that all three confirmed what then?
That the Earth is in the center of the universe.
On the basis of the hot and cold spots.
Yes.
Whose alignment represents an X.
An X.
And at the center of the X is the Earth.
Right. And they call that X the axis of evil. That was coined.
The scientists call that the axis of
called
evil.
Called it the axis of evil. That was coined in 2004 when Bush went into Iraq. Remember he called them the axis of evil? So this cosmologist just picked it up and said, yeah, well, here's the axis of evil right here. In the universe.
So, in other words, they're enraged by the finding.
Oh, yeah.
Because it upsets their worldview, which has to displace the Earth's special position in the universe, which fits in rather nicely with a divinely created universe.
Right.
Made for man.
All of cosmology is based on what we call the Copernican principle. Every piece of data that they get in their telescope has to be filtered through the Copernican principle. And that's what the Big Bang theory does, NASA does it, ESA does it, everybody does it. The upsetting thing about this microwave radiation is it just totally defies the Copernican principle.
The last probe confirmed that as well, you say?
The last probe, yeah. As a matter of fact...
Where was that result reported? Obviously everywhere, but give me some examples.
March 21st in the European Space Agency report. As a matter of fact, it's in our movie.
What's their attempt to explain the latest probe's findings away?
Anomalies.
Anomalies?
Mm-hmm.
And all the anomalies conveniently line up in a non-anomalous way to verify their model.
Right.
This is amazing. Yeah. So this brings us to the question of motive. We've been hinting at it throughout the discussion. There's obviously a motive at work here. Many people have recognized, not just believers, not just Catholics, but people like David Berlinski, for example, that science has become an ideology. Mm. Maybe you could take up that theme as we close out this interview.
Yeah.
Isn't there an ideological component?
Yeah, I would even go so far as to say it's a religion. Science is a religion today. It's scientism. And they've already got the parameters within which they want to interpret the data. And they're not going to go outside those parameters. This is a perfect example. You do get some of them that break out of it, and they say, yeah, well, this defies the Copernican principle. We've read many papers like that, and we quote them in our book. Okay, but the motivation is, if the Copernican principle is wrong, that means all of science is wrong. Everything, cosmogony, paleontology, cosmology, archaeology, everything now becomes suspect because we can't support these long ages. We can't support this vast universe. As a matter of fact, we're in the center of it. How does that happen? Well, it's not going to happen by chance. Someone had to put it there. You see, and that's what they're scared of. That's the motivation.
Well, I notice that even within the Catholic Church, it seems as if churchmen, and David Berlinski pointed this out in an interview I did with him, churchmen have been cowed into submission by the scientific establishment. They're so afraid of appearing backward and being subjected to ridicule that they swallowed the modern scientific worldview entirely. And so the Pontifical Academy for the Sciences, for example, has become essentially a think tank for evolutionists, evolutionary cosmologists and evolutionary biologists. But on this point, I would note something important that was discovered by Father Brian Harrison through the research of someone else, that the Pope's famous statement, John Paul II's famous statement to the Pontifical Academy for the Sciences, that evolution is more than a hypothesis, guess what? He never actually gave that speech.
Right.
Have you heard this?
I've heard that, yeah.
He wrote it out, or someone wrote it out for his signature, made some additions to it, and published it as his address to the Academy, which the Pope himself never gave.
The same thing happened in his 1992 address about Galileo. He never wrote the script.
Unbelievable.
Yeah.
Well, so why is the Church permitted this invasion of the religion of scientism into the precincts of the Church, into the Pontifical Academy for the Sciences itself, which is composed of, largely, as far as I can tell, of non-believers?
Well, it was this whole movement that started in the late 1880s with Catholic theologians, liberal theologians, who wanted to do away with the miraculous and only talk about the natural. And that's why we're having trouble with Fatima today, because nobody believes in the miracle anymore. That's why Donis came along and said, oh, it's just her childhood fantasies, you see. Same thing with science. Everything happens naturally, you see. God can't create things like this and put it in the center of the universe. It just doesn't happen, you see.
Well, of course, God can't do that. He's only God. He can create man, but he can't put the earth in the center of the universe. Of course, it's ludicrous. I mean, to deny the miraculous is to deny the existence of a God who is the author of nature. And you're right, this does tie in with the Fatima event. It seems to me that churchmen who pay lip service to the message of Fatima treat it as if they really don't believe in it.
Yeah.
I mean, I gave a talk yesterday in which Cardinal Ratzinger was asked whether the vision of the bishop in white outside the half-ruined city, clearly an apocalyptic scenario, the Pope is executed outside the city on a hill, whether that vision might not relate to some kind of nuclear catastrophe, a nuclear war. And he said, I would say, no. Now, if he believed that the vision is authentic, would he venture a guess as to whether it means an apocalyptic scenario, a nuclear war for mankind? No. So the problem is that churchmen pay lip service to Fatima.
Yeah.
They pay lip service to the miraculous, but they allow belief in Fatima and the miraculous in general to be undermined.
Sometimes
science has triumphed in this area, it seems.
Sometimes I find the secular scientists are more honest with the data than those in the Catholic Church. Here's a good example. Stephen Hawking, very famous physicist, probably as famous as Einstein was in his day. Stephen Hawking, in his book Brief Time of History, and this book sold, I think, 10 to 15 million copies. Very popular guy. He said, yeah, I know the evidence, when we look out into the universe, puts the Earth in the center of the universe. He said that. But he says, I want to be humble. And if I take that position, it's a proud position. So I'm going to try to find another solution. And that's where this whole expansion idea of the universe came along. Hubble, I don't know if you're familiar with this at all.
Sure.
Well, what we're going to do is we're going to put the Earth on the surface of a balloon, and we're going to expand all these galaxies and the Earth and its galaxy like it was on a balloon, and that way we can't tell if there's a center.
So the hypothesis drove the data instead of the data driving the hypothesis.
Exactly, yeah. But here's a man who's a famous physicist who admits that the data points to the Earth in the center of the universe but can't accept it because of his philosophical disposition, you see.
Bob, thanks for these tidbits from your book. It's only a slight sampling of what you've written about. But to our critics of the Fatima Center, especially people from the loony left who might be watching this video, open your eyes and open your mind to alternative possibilities. Thanks again, Bob.
You're welcome. My pleasure.
I have come to warn the faithful to amend their lives and ask pardon for their sins. They must not continue to offend our Lord, who is already deeply offended. Final vision on October 13, 1917. Our Lady silently held out the scapular, a gesture which indicates that she wants everyone to wear it.